Praise team. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. How about it today? How about it, guys? How about it, folks? How about it, congregation? Can you, are you, will you tell the story that God and what God has done in and through your life? Are you telling that story? Do people know who you are? So this morning, as we dive into the text, Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17, the title of the message is Presenting the New Man. So if you have Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17, would you please stand in the honoring of the reading of God's Word? Verse 12 says, Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, that which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of God dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your testimony. We thank you for the life that you've given us because you live. We can face tomorrow, and God, we thank you for that. Be with the hearers today. Be with me as I teach the word, preach the word. Just help your words be in and through me. Lord, if there's anything that I say that is not of you, please let it go on the wayside. Lord, we thank you for letting the word of God dwell in us richly. Lord, just please help us to learn it, and to hear it, and to heed to it. And I thank you for loving us. I thank you for dying for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. So the title of the message is Presenting the New Man. As I was thinking about this title, as this text, it might be not the right application, but I was thinking about my father-in-law. My father-in-law was a carpenter for 40 years. He worked for McKnight Construction. He was a carpenter. And every morning, he would make sure his tools were in the back of the truck. He would make sure when he got done with the job that he would put his tools back in his toolbox and put them back in his truck, so when he went to the next job, he knew where they were. He always had the right tools. He was prepared because he was a carpenter by trade, and he knew what he needed for the job that he was going to do. If he went to a different job and he needed a different tool, he would get it out of his building and put it in his truck so he could have it on the job. He was prepared. So I wanted to tie that with the scripture today, just to use that that picture, that image, that illustration of what we as believers should do. Do you understand that as a child of the King, as someone that has been changed by God, by his death, crucifixion, his burial, his resurrection, we have all the tools in our tool belt that we need to do whatever God wants us to do. I love verse 17. It goes along with Corinthians 10:31, but 17 says, "And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." We have no excuse, people. We have no excuse. We are if Jesus Christ has changed your life and made you new, everything you need to do everything he wants you to do has already been prepared and already been granted to you. You are full of the Holy Spirit, so go and do what he wants us to do. As a child of the King, as a new man, as a new creature, we should do the things that he would have us to do. I love verse 2. I'll get there in just a minute. But everything that we are called to do, what are we called to do? Witness. To go out. Everything that we are called to do, we have been equipped. Second Timothy 3:16 and 17. That the man of God may be fully equipped. Everything that we need, everything that we are going to do for his glory, should be for his glory, but we have already been prepared and equipped with that. And we must renew our mind every day with the word of God, that we are looking and seeking his will and only his will. So three steps I want us to realize. First, as a child of the God, we must accept. What does John 20:31, we've been in John, what does that say? It says, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and believing you may have life in his name. We must accept, we must believe, and we must follow everything he would have us to do. So verse 12 says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, and long-suffering. Now, I want to I'm not going there the whole way. We're not going to talk about things that are uncomfortable this morning. But I want to talk about those four words just for a minute. Therefore, as the elect of God. I don't want to scare you. I'm not going to dive into this deep theological discussion. But you understand what that really is talking about? To me, I believe it's not talking about any, many, miny, mo, catch a tiger by his toe. I don't think that word is talking about that. But I do think it's talking about John chapter 6, verse 44 says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will rise him up at the last day. I don't think it's any, many, mighty, mo, catch a tiger by his toe. I don't believe that word that we've been scared of all of our life. Oh, there's no way. And like I said, I'm not getting there. I believe that, therefore, as the elect of God, therefore, as ones that have been called of God, ones that the Holy Spirit has drawn us to himself. If you'll see, it says no one. No one, not you, not you, not you, not me, no one can come to the Father unless, it says, he draws him. No one. And that's what the therefore as the elect, we have been changed, we have been renewed, we have been transformed. We are no longer the man that we used to be. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. As the elect, as the ones that has been changed by him. It doesn't stop there. As the elect, as the ones that have been changed, we have been equipped with everything that we need. So it says, holy and beloved. Put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, and long sufferings. And also, I want you to look at that therefore, that word that begins. You've heard this many times. You've heard this from many preachers, from many evangelists. Therefore, we need to look to see what that word therefore is there for. So if you will, go to verse 1 of Colossians chapter 3, and we will see why that therefore is there. Verse 1 says, if then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. So therefore, as the elect of God, verse 1 answers that question. If then you have been raised with Christ, if Jesus Christ has changed your life, if you are a new man, you have to put on the other stuff that is there. It's already there for you, but you have to understand that it is our part to die daily to self and do what God wants us to do. It says in verse 1, if then you were raised with Christ, if Christ has changed your life, if Christ has made you new, and you are no longer the dead man you used to be, and now you are made alive, seek those things which are above. Where Christ is. Where is Christ? He's sitting on the right hand of the Father. So if you're raised, if Jesus Christ has changed your life, seek those things. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Verse 2, set your mind on things above, not on the things of the earth. Do you understand all this stuff that is going on in the world is bothersome? It can stress us out. But we must always go back to Scripture to get guidance for everything that is happening in and through our life. I love verse 2. We can tie that to Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. This is what verse 2 is saying. Set your mind on things above. I don't care what's going on in your life. That sounded bad. I do care what's going on in your life. But I don't care what's going on in your life. You picking up what I'm putting down? Don't worry about it. The Bible tells us all the time to not be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer and supplications, make your requests known to God. Don't let things of this world drag you down. In the back of Revelations, it tells us we are victorious because he was victorious. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Set your mind on things above. Don't get drugged down with the things that are going on in this world. Because he is victorious. Set your mind on things above, not on things this earth. Verse 3, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. No longer the dead bones that I used to have, or no longer the dead bones that I used to be. You remember, Elijah or Elisha? I get those two mixed up. Dry bones, Elisha, right? Was it Elisha? Dry bones. They come alive. Why? Because God made them come alive. Just like the dry bones right here. Come alive. We were dead. For you were dead before I was dead. And your life is hidden with Christ. He is our mediator. He is the only way we can come to the Father. We are no longer the dead bones that we used to be. He has made us alive. He has made us new. When Christ, who is our life. I want you to see that right there. When Christ, who is our life. It's no longer, if you are a child of the King, if Jesus Christ has changed your life, it is no longer your life to live. It is Jesus who lives in and through you. It's no longer yours to live. We need to do everything. 17, what does it say? Whatever you do in deed, in whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord. It is no longer my life to live. It's everything that Jesus Christ has done in and through me. And I need to do everything that he wants me to do and be obedient to his commandment and his will alone. It's no longer my life. It's his life. When Christ, who is our life, appears, he's coming back for us. Then you also will appear with him in glory. 1 Peter 1, 13 through 16 says, therefore, again, you could go back. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13, you could go back to verse 12 and see why this therefore is there. It says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober. Be clear-minded. Have your heart and your mind prepared. Gird up the loins of your mind. Be ready. Be sober and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God yesterday is gone. All my hope is in Jesus. You hear? You see? First Peter 1:13, therefore, gird up your loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourself to the former lust, as in your arrogance. Is that arrogance or ignorance? Thank you. But as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in your conduct. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. Gird up the loins of your mind. Why? Be ye holy, for I am holy. If Jesus Christ has changed your life, if Jesus Christ has changed your direction, and you are now following him, what he has for your life, you are holy because he lives in you. It is not your life anymore. You can never be holy on your own. He has already made you holy. It is no longer your life. And we as Christians, as saints, as believers, as the church, we should live that way. What kind of story are you telling? Are you telling them the story of Jesus? Are you telling them the story of doom and gloom? Oh, poor old pitiful me. You remember the story, the cartoon Pooh Bear? Pooh Bear, Winnie the Pooh Bear, Eeyore. Oh, poor me. Jesus Christ has made you alive. If he's made you new, we cannot go around this world looking like Eeyore. We have to be risen. We are risen with him. He has already made us alive. We have to live our life that way. Tell the story of Jesus. Tell the story of Jesus. John 15, 6. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask in the name, in the Father, in my name, he may give you. Jeremiah 1:5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Jeremiah 1:5 is talking to Jeremiah, but Jesus Christ appointed him in his mother's womb. He has made you. He has changed you. He has made you new and set your feet on the path that he wants for your life. We must accept the love he's given us. We must believe in everything that he is doing, and we must follow everything that he wants us to do. 2 Timothy 1, 8 through 9 says, therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoners, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his purpose and grace, which has given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. Jesus Christ has made you new. Jesus Christ has drawn you to himself. If Jesus Christ has changed you, I hope you have accepted that. I hope you follow that. I hope you believe that. I hope you do everything that he wants you to do because he has done everything for you. Let me read verse 12 and then we'll move to 13. It says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy, being changed of God, we are holy and beloved. Put on tender mercies. That is something we have to do daily. Got me? That's the part of the three things, accept, believe, and following. That's a part of following. Daily, we have to put on these things, just like Ephesians chapter 6 tells us to put on the full armor of God. We have to daily take up our cross daily and follow him. It says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering. Verse 13, bearing one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. It's hard. I promise you, forgiveness to someone that has hurt you is hard. But what does the scripture say? It says, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. Scripture tells us everything that we need to do. If someone has hurt you, if someone has hurt me, it is our responsibility to go and forgive them or forgive them because Christ has already forgave them. You cannot serve God the way you need to serve God or the way God wants you to serve if there is a barrier between you and God. What is prayer? Prayer is aligning up my life with his will for my life. And if there's anything in that way, is there a barrier in that way, we have to repent. We have to move that in order to get close to him. Matthew 5, 23 through 24 says, therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Last week, I talked about being a vessel of mercy, being a clean vessel. Jesus Christ has made us clean, but we have to renew our mind every day, every week, every moment, every second. The Bible tells us to pray without ceasing. We have to renew our mind on a constant basis. There are so many things that floods into my mind. I have to stop and pray, and God, please forgive me and just help me to do what you would have me to be and do. You know that there's a song that, or a thing that my mom used to say, sticks and stones may hurt you, break your bones, but words will never hurt you. That's a lie. Words can hurt. Words will hurt. But Jesus Christ has forgiven you, so we also should forgive others. We should bear one another's burdens. It says bearing with one another and forgiving one another. We, Ephesians 6 says, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Put on the full armor of God. Bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. And then verse 14 says, but above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your heart, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Colossians 3, 5 through 10. We'll go back to scriptures to understand scriptures. Verse 5 says, therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourself once walked, when you lived in them. But now you yourself are put to put off all these, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Verse 5, therefore put to death your members. And you understand that we are not sinless, but we should sin less. You've heard me say that many times. Why should we sin less? Because it's Christ that lives in us. If Jesus Christ has changed your life today, you should sin less. And in order to sin less, we should be in the Word of God more, seeking what He wants for us to do, praying, lining up our life with Him. Those things, the fornication, the uncleanliness, the passion, the evil desires and covetousness, which is idolatry, should no longer be a part of us. You hear me? You are what you do. You practice. Practice makes perfect, but perfect practice makes perfect. Right? If we are to align ourselves with the will of God, we should be in the Word. We don't have to be there anymore. But James 1, 13 through 15 says, we commit sins when we are drawn away. Don't let that come into your life. It doesn't have to be. We are not sinless. We should sin less. We have to renew our minds. Verse 2, go back to verse 2. It says, set your mind on things above, not on the things of the earth. You don't have to live there anymore. We have a new nature. We're no longer the dead man. He has changed us and made us new. Verse 10, and have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. Jesus Christ has made me new. I no longer am the old man. It's not two natures anymore fighting against one another. It's Jesus Christ who lives in me and has made me new. Yes, I still sin. But I don't have to, because it doesn't rule my life anymore. It's not in me. It's not about me. Jesus Christ lives in me and has made me new. Verse 16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. How is it going to dwell in you if you never open it up? How is it going to dwell in me if I never open it up? If I never read it? If I never pray over it? If I never spend time with him in his word? How is something going to dwell in you if you never have a part of it? If Jesus Christ has not changed your life, then this word, this text does not apply to you. But if he has saved you and changed you, in order for the word to dwell in you, you have to get in it. Sleeping on it at night will not help it. Pounding your head with scriptures will not get it in there. But meditating, praying, seeking his will, reading his will, is how the word of God dwells in you. The word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Hide thy word in thy heart that I might not sin against thee. You have to hide it in order to use it in situations where Satan brings into your life. How did Jesus fight Satan when he came out of the wilderness? As it is written. You can't say as it is written if you never read it. If it's not part of you. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. It says, teaching and admonishing. We should come together. It says iron sharpens iron. If there's anything that I say, please come to me if it's not matching up with Scripture. Please, I'll do the same to you. We should come to one another. Iron sharpens iron. We are to help one another. We should follow Christ, but we come together. Do not forsake the assembly of God. I am so glad that you're back this morning. It took us a year to get back together. But we need this. We need this fellowship. Iron sharpens iron. I can't sharpen another brother if I never go see him, or if that brother never comes to see me. We have to be together. We have to come together. We have to be united for one body, and that's Jesus Christ. It says, for teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Psalms 113, verse 3. Can you put that on the screen? Thank you. It says, singing psalms and spiritual songs. So I want to sing this. How many of you know this chorus? From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord shall be praised. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord shall be praised. Can you sing with me again? From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord shall be praised. From the rising of the sun, from the going down of the same, the name of the Lord shall be praised. So praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord shall be praised. That's what we are supposed to do together in psalms and songs and spiritual songs. We have to come together. We have to be united. Set your mind on things above, not on the things of the earth. We get so caught up on the things, on the news. I don't even turn the news on anymore. I get stressed out. I don't even turn it on. But there's so many things going on in this world that that has entrapped our mind, that has entrapped us. We are we're more focused on things that are going on around us than we are what the Word of God can change us. Set your mind on things above, not on the things of the earth. Read that. Sing it. You learned it. If you didn't know it before this morning, you know it. Now, if you're having a bad day, go to Psalms 113:3. From the rising of the sun to its going down, the Lord's name shall be praised. Praise you, the Lord. Praise you, the Lord. What does it say in Matthew 6, 9 through 13? Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let the word, verse 16. Let the word dwell in you richly. So when something comes up in your life, Scripture can come to your mind. Let it saturate your mind and marinate your heart. So everything about you is the Word of God. He gives it to us to use. We have to tell His story. Verse 17, please. And whatever you do. Oh, that's clear. I don't have to explain that. What does it say? And whatever you do. In word or deed. What's the rest of it? Whatever. Whether you're washing the car, cutting grass, cooking dinner, going down the road, stuck in traffic. Hey, that's where you need the script. That's where I need scriptures the most, is in traffic. Trina tells me all the time, boy, you have road rage. I need scripture then. But whatever you do, in word or deed, it doesn't say do some of it. It doesn't say do what you want or do most. What's the word behind do? All. Do all. Everything that you do. Do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Can you pull up 2 Corinthians 10:31, please? It's not in there, I'm sorry. I thought it was in there. 10:31, or 1 Corinthians 10:31. One of those Corinthians. Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. Presenting the new man. Jesus Christ draws us to Himself. We accept that. We believe on that, His name, and we follow everything that He would have us to do. Whether in word or deed, whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. Let me ask you today. Let me ask you today. If Jesus Christ has changed your life, are you doing all you can for the glory of God? Don't answer that. But I want you to ask that question to yourself, and I want you to answer it honestly. Because guess what? God knows whether you are or not. I don't. You don't know whether I am, but God knows. But I will tell you this. If you are not doing everything you can to glorify God, and in everything that you are doing, you're glorifying God, you need to get right with God. Your life needs to be lined up with His will for you. You cannot live a separate life. You're either in the world or Christ is in you. You can't do both. If Christ has changed your life, you cannot live in the world and be happy. If Jesus Christ is in you, and you are in the world, you should be miserable. The Holy Spirit should be dwelling and making you miserable until you get right with God. In order to set my mind on things above, I have to be in the Word of God. I can't get it from ESPN or Fox News or CNN or whatever other news outlet. I can't get what the Word wants for my life from anybody else but the Word of God. Let the Word of God dwell in you richly. And whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. Father, we thank You today. We praise You today. Just please fill us with You and just help us to be what You would have us to be today. Lord, I thank You for the Word. Lord, if there's anything that I said this morning that was not of You, please let it come. Let it be passed away. And Lord, we thank You for loving us. We thank You for dying for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The altar is open. If you are not setting your mind on things above, you can get it right. Oh, you don't have to come to the altar. But if you do come to the altar, that's a testimony for everybody else that you want to set your life right with God and you want to do everything God wants for your life. Thank you. Stand.